Good morning. How you doing? I don't normally like to talk about myself, but in this case, I was asked to share with you my story, and so that's what I'm going to do. But I believe that we all have our own stories, and there's a reason why you're where you are, sitting in that seat. And as I'm telling you mine, I want you to think about yours and what brought you here. More importantly, I want you to think about, are you here by accident? Because I don't think that you are. My story begins right where you're sitting, right where you are. I was in college. I just finished high school. And whether it be by the fault of my high school or maybe something about me, I didn't have to try very hard to do well in high school. And I thought I could go to college and keep that same intensity, that same work ethic, and succeed. And I was wrong. I was very wrong. I was what you would call a poor student. I got bad grades. And it probably would have stayed that way, but for one very important event that happened in my life, and that was when I met this woman. And for whatever reason, she liked me. She liked me so much that she fell in love with me. And it wasn't until years later that I realized why. Because she didn't see me for who I was. She saw me for who I could be. She saw my potential. And over the next couple of years, after we got married and I moved to Auburn to be with her as she finished up professional school, she cultivated me and helped me realize that potential. It was after we moved to Auburn, she introduced me to her favorite restaurant. And we ate at this restaurant 2 to 3 times a week, and we loved it. I mean, we ate it too much, I would say. Probably an unhealthy amount. A couple years later, after she graduates from professional school, we moved to Montgomery, and she takes her career, and that forced me to have to leave my career and to begin something new. And I applied to probably 20, 25 different businesses that I thought I was very capable of being performing that job and doing that work. I thought my combination of experience and education at the time made me overqualified for many of them. But wouldn't you know it, I didn't receive the first interview, not the first phone call. And so it was on a weekend trip back to Auburn. We were going back for a football game. We visited our favorite restaurant. We saw a little placard that said, "Franchising opportunities now available." And credit my wife, she called the corporate office for Chicken Salad Chick and set up an arrangement, a meeting. And we met with them, and we fell in love with them. We fell in love with their concept, and they fell in love with us. And it was, what really sold it was their values aligned with mine. I could be who I wanted to be. I could lead my company the way I wanted to lead it because our values aligned. They were a Christian company, and they were unashamedly so. But still, that's a big decision, so we had a lot of thinking, a lot of due diligence in front of us, and we gathered together a group of people that we really cared about their opinion. We cared about what they had to say, and one of those people was my father-in-law, and we knew that if we were going to be successful, we would need his support. And so I remember the phone call. I asked him, I said, "Do you think it's a good idea?" And I wasn't expecting just a flat no. Just no. He said, "You have to remember, me and my stage of life, I have different priorities. I have different things that I want to accomplish. And this isn't one of them. And after looking at the numbers and what you're telling me that you could do within this opportunity, it just doesn't make financial sense to me. So I wouldn't do it." Well, that hurt. That set us back, and we had to go back to the drawing table and really think about, is this something that we thought we could do? And after a lot of prayer and a lot of thought, it wasn't until that we were on a car ride and we had this conversation about what would failure look like. We had a good idea about what success would look like, but what would failure look like? And we discussed how no matter if we succeeded or if we failed, we were going to use our experience to honor God. You see, if we succeeded, we would hopefully have some material resources that we could be a blessing to others and pay it forward and do some really great things in our community and our church. But if we failed, we would have a story. We would have an experience. We could show others what it looks like to fail as a Christian. And it wasn't until I had a clear picture about what failure looked like and how I could glorify God no matter if I succeeded or if I failed that it really freed me up to make this decision. So I remember calling my father-in-law back. That was a tough phone call. I remember telling him, hey, I know that you think that this is not a very good decision. I know that you said you wouldn't do it, but we're going to do it anyway. And he said, I understand. I'll support you 100%. That was huge. But I wasn't ready for him to say what he said next. And he said, I just know one thing for sure. You're going to have to sell a lot of chicken salad. Well, thankfully, that's exactly what we did. I remember sitting in a restaurant the day before opening and talking with the founders and asking them, how much do you think we should prepare? He said, 120 pounds. Have you ever seen 120 pounds of chicken salad? That is a lot of chicken salad. Wouldn't you know it, the first day we sold out by 3:30. 120 pounds of chicken salad sold out in 5 hours. That's crazy. So the next day we prepared 160 pounds of chicken salad. It couldn't even hardly fit in our cooler. Well, apparently those that came the first day told their friends because we sold out again by 3:30 the next day. And we continued that momentum throughout our first year, and we ended up setting the company record. Of course, it was a young company at the time, but we set the company record in revenue in our first year. We continued that success for the next year after that, opening up two more restaurants and each one being successful. And we thought we had it made, that this was easy. Well, I was wrong. The very next year was our worst year ever. We dropped 33% in sales in 1 year. You don't have to be a math wizard to understand that 33% of anything is a lot. That was a tough time. We had to make some very difficult decisions. We had to shore up our operations so that we could sustain, and thankfully that was a brief period in our company's history because we turned it around. And what I'm thankful for is that those lessons that we learned in that very difficult year, very trying year, made us more successful in the future. It allowed us to grow year on year for 5 consecutive years. And nothing could stop us except for, well, a global pandemic. And 2020, again, was another challenging year, but I'm thankful that we had already gone through adversity because it was the lessons that we learned 5 years before that carried us through and allowed us to remain profitable, allowed us to remain successful, allowed us to keep our employees even amidst a global pandemic. That's my first lesson for you, is that adversity brings about success. In James chapter 1, verse 2, it says, count it all joy, my brethren, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that testing of your faith produces steadfastness. I want you to think about a goal that you have. And I want you to think about a goal in which it didn't take much effort, it didn't take much time or determination to achieve this goal. How rewarding was that goal? Did it bring about a lot of personal satisfaction? I want you thinking about a goal that you have where you had to struggle. You had to overcome adversity. You faced great challenges. You put in enormous amounts of effort. And then you achieved that goal. How much more satisfaction did you derive from that because you faced that adversity? How much more did it feel? How much better did it feel because of the challenges that you went through? You see, it was because of our lows, our lowest lows, that we get to experience the highest highs. If we had no adversity, if we had no struggles, would we really know what success felt like? I think success is only that, and only feels good, feels what it is, because we get to contrast it with our difficulties. So that's the first lesson. We sustained through the global pandemic, and it was about this time that we got approached by another franchisee who was looking to expand. And they wanted to expand into the Montgomery market. And again, we were faced with another challenging decision. We had built a successful company. We had done things that we always wanted to do and helped people and created a work environment in which people felt comfortable coming to work, and we could treat them and show them the love of Christ every single day. We could show the love of Christ to those around us in our community. So it would have meant a lot to give that up, And again, it wasn't until a lot of prayer and a lot of deliberation that we thought about, well, what's next? And it wasn't until that we realized that we could move on and do other things and still glorify God. And really, what freed me up to make that decision was I knew what I wanted to do next. I wanted to be here. I am right where I want to be. I love my job. I love coming into the classroom and getting to hear your story. But I'm not alone. This university is filled with staff members, with faculty members, with administrators who feel the exact same way. I see a lot of them shaking their heads. They care about you. They care about who you are. They care about, of course, making you academically successful and being productive people when you leave. But beyond that, they care about your soul. And I can tell you from firsthand experience, and I know there's many in this room that can tell you that that is not the case everywhere you go. Those of you that's transferred from somewhere else have probably experienced that, and I know I experienced it in my education. That you're always sometimes treated like a number, you're treated like an object, like a grade. That's not the case here. So I hope that you make the most of this opportunity. President Henry's talked a lot about being a vocational minister. And I want to tell you that that is something that you can do after you leave and you graduate and you take on your career. But it's also something that you can do right now. You have one of the greatest vocations in the world currently. You're a student. And if I could start over my life at any point in my life, that's exactly where I would start. I would press rewind and I would go back to being a student. Sure, it's difficult. Sure, it's hard. But it is the best job in the world. And here's a couple ways that I think you can go ahead and become a vocational minister right now. You don't have to wait. The first one is I think you need to show up. In Colossians chapter 3, Paul makes a couple of statements there. The first one in verse 17, he says, whatever you do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord. And then later in verse 23 and 24, he says, whatever you do, work heartily, as for the Lord, and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord. Work hard. Work hard in the classroom. Give it your best effort. Work hard on the field, whatever sport it is that you're playing. Work hard. Work hard for your coaches. Work hard for your instructors. Work hard for your fellow students and teammates. Remember, best goals in life are the ones in which we put forth maximum effort to achieve. The second one is be an example to others. Be a good example to others. You see, in every relationship, there are two types of people. There's an influencer and there's somebody being influenced. If you're an influencer, how are you using your influence on other people? Are you bringing them up? Are you bringing them closer to heaven? Or are you leading them further away towards the darkness? If you're being influenced, nothing wrong with that. The world needs followers. Who are you following? Are they leading you to heaven? Are they leading you away? I'm not saying you ditch your friends, but you need to be really cognizant of what it is that I'm getting out of this relationship. Am I influencing someone for the better? Am I following somebody that's leading me closer to heaven? And then the last one is, you cannot reach your full potential until you are a follower of Christ. You see, my wife, she led me, yes, to help me receive my full potential, but she also helped me and led me to Christ. And if you haven't done that yet, I would encourage you to ask, to seek, to find. The room is full of people that care about your soul, and they want to see you come to Christ. If you like to talk to me, I would love to. Send me an email. I would love to meet with you and to talk with you. If you have another faculty member or another staff member, another student that you trust, reach out to them. Because I know they would feel the same way. They want to see you come to Christ. President Henry's been talking a lot about in the midst of a great awakening at this campus. And I can't help but think that we're at a tipping point. And I think that there's just a few more students, a few more people, that if they strove to reach their full potential, that we would reach that tipping point and carry over into realize what this university could really be, to realize its full potential. You know, sometimes we're climbing and we think we're on a mountain. And we think that every time we step, we look up and we have just as much more to go. But I don't think that's what we're on doing here as a whole, as a university. I think we're more like on a teeter-totter or a seesaw. Sure, we're climbing. And it looks like there's a lot more to go, but there's a certain point at which you reach critical mass and you go over the edge and you're there. That's the way these things work. It's not going to take everyone. It just takes a few of you. You can make a difference. If you devote yourself to reaching your full potential now, you can make a very lasting impact in this university for years to come. And that's what excites me. It excites me that I get to play a small role in your story. Your story is largely unwritten. Where are you going to go? What are you going to do? Sky's the limit. But I implore you, don't wait until you leave to begin like I did. Do it now. Right now. Make that decision that you're going to be a good influence, that you're going to work hard, and if you haven't already, that you're going to follow Christ.